Those who witness Jesus' authority and healing power are amazed. In today's gospel account of Jesus entering Capernaum, those who heard his teaching and witnessed him drive out an unclean spirit are astonished. Their amazement is due to the authority of Christ, who is God himself. Are we too in awe at the work of God in our lives? Thank you.
Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Good evening and welcome. And as church, we always gather as we sang in the opening hymn. Let the Amen sound from his people again, gladly with praise. We adore him. So we indeed gather to praise our Heavenly Father. And as we do so, let us acknowledge also our sins and to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mystery.
Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
words into his mouth. He shall tell them all that I command him. Whoever will not listen to my words when he speaks in my name, I myself will make him answer for it. But if a prophet presumes to speak in my name, an oracle that I have not commanded for him to speak, or speaks in the name of other gods, he shall die. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I should like you to be free of anxieties. An unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But a married man is anxious about the things of the world, how he may please his wife, and he is divided. An unmarried woman or a virgin is anxious about the things of the Lord, so that she may be holy in both body and spirit. A married woman, on the other hand, is anxious about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. I am telling you this for your own benefit, not to impose a restraint on you, but for the sake of propriety and adherence the Lord without distraction. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
entered the synagogue and taught. The people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. In their synagogue was a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Jesus rebuked him and said, "Quiet, come out of him." The unclean spirit convulsed him, and with a loud cry came out of him. All were amazed and asked one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." His fame spread everywhere throughout the whole region of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As stated in Psalm 95 today, we are so fortunate that we can come together physically or by live streaming. To do what? To sing joyfully to the Lord, to acclaim the rock of our salvation. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. I wonder how many times we fail to live out the gospel because we either are not listening or we are indeed listening, but we harden our hearts because we really don't want to do what God is asking us to do. Perhaps we think we're not worthy enough, not strong enough in faith, not have the skills to do what God is challenging us to do. Now, God does use each and every one of us in small and sometimes larger ways to further his gospel, to further his kingdom. Whether we do it ourselves, or we enable other people to bring the gospel more fully to one another. So this weekend is our invitation to be church, to be for one another, to bring the gospel to more people, specifically through the Diocesan Services Fund. This is not a money talk, folks. To talk about who we are as Catholics to bring the gospel to more people. And the first challenge is just to listen, to have an open mind, even if some of you are skeptical, even when we have heard the talk before. To listen exactly how the larger church, the archdiocese, through some 60-plus ministries, reach out to different people. Reaching out to others, whether when we as individuals or even individual parishes cannot do it alone. That we must enable others to bring the light of Christ to others. So now let us watch the Cardinal's video about DSF and listen to his words.
First time I ever heard the Cardinal not speak, but anyway.
plus ministries. Well, what happens to them during COVID-19 time? Can I give you a couple of examples of some of our ministries and how they function and operate at this time? Take, for example, our Catholic Schools Office. Friends, I can't tell you how innovative and talented our Schools Office has been in working with our school principals, our Catholic school teachers, in finding ways for them to teach virtually even while they're teaching person to person. That requires real skill. And although there are skills in education, which I consider to be very important, and we're second to none, we are weaving themes of faith and our Catholic tradition in our school life. Where indeed the reason for a Catholic school education is to thread faith and life together.
I will say that this year has been especially challenging for our schools as we have managed educating our students amidst the COVID-19 pandemic, which has brought us many opportunities to adapt to a constantly changing educational environment. We have also been challenged to provide additional tuition assistance and technology support to families whose circumstances were impacted by the coronavirus. Our pastors, principals, and school staff have been incredible. They are warriors out there, and I thank them for their selfless service to our schools.
I take my role as a teacher and an administrator in the Catholic schools very seriously. It's a vocation for me to be a part of Catholic education. COVID-19 has brought upon challenges to all schools and how we can best support the needs of our students during this time. The Catholic Schools Office has been very focused in helping devise plan for schools in which they can reopen in a safe health environment under these conditions. I, this last year, have been the art teacher here, and I have been able to hold my classes using Zoom technology and can say how very effective it has been. Catholic schools are a valuable asset to our society. What makes them different than public schools is that we can address and instill the gospel values into our students. God will not ask me how well did I teach, but he's going to ask me, how many souls did you bring to me? How many lives did you help transform using my message and bringing my will, the kingdom of God, into the world?
In all our work in DSF, a really important office is our Office of Adolescent Catechesis and Evangelization. That particular office works with, well, our young people, those teenagers, who are so important for the faith. And so we have a youth office that's very intent, even in these pandemic times, to meet with young people. They're the future of our faith, and so we need to care for them and to shine the light of Christ on their expectant hearts and minds.
When we look at what's happening with adolescents today, many of them become disaffiliated by the time they're 15, 16, 17 years old. And so the key mission of our office, and one of the reasons we exist, is so that we can assist young people, we can assist parishes, to help provide the discipleship experiences, the encounters with Christ, that are necessary become a lifelong disciple.
I grew up with my grandfather. My parents were there, and he was by their side. I think it was around first grade or kindergarten. I heard something about him having cancer. He just got sick. He passed away. And that was when my faith was truly tested. I was lucky enough to be raised on a Catholic education, and I found that answer through my faith. I always have something to go back to now. I have the Catholic Church, and that is my foundation.
The primary method to engage young people is through working with the youth ministry leaders in the parishes, training them, resourcing them, mentoring them. The second is to work with the Archdiocesan Youth Council.
The role of the Archdiocesan Youth Council is to serve the Archdiocesan at large. We meet together roughly 3 times a year. Our job is to help the adults have a direct lens into the youth.
We are boots on the ground with young people. This year, because of COVID, again, it was a matter of where are young people in the midst of this? We gathered, of course, online, all of our youth council and said, what are you experiencing? What's happening in your life right now? And so they provide us with all kinds of responses, which then we send forth to all the parish agencies. Here's what we're hearing from young people.
The COVID-19 pandemic is something that's really different in the sense that we're all disconnected. The benefits of having a strong faith is, you know, there's someone out there. Having that mentality has truly helped me to weather the storm, no matter how long it's going to last.
One of the offices we are highlighting this year is the Office of Vocations. Becoming a priest is not short-term. Many of our young people, from the time they enter the seminary until the time they are ordained, may spend 9 or 10 years in seminary and in formation. The maturing in your vocational call to priesthood is what the Office of Vocations does, and it's an expert at that.
The Office of Vocations really works with the future of the church. We're accompanying young people who are just grasping their relationship and identity in Jesus, that they're somehow sons and daughters of the Heavenly Father, and we're trying to help them to the next step. What are they called to do? What is their mission? And it's those deep questions that I think I'm hearing young people beginning to ponder that are really going to drive them deeper into the church's mission of discerning their vocation, of finding their purpose in a new way through God. But we really want to find the right men, the ones God has called, and then not just that, you want to make sure they're ready, that no one makes it to ordination without climbing that mountain of transformation, by giving them the tools that they need, and then really kind of accompanying them, and really trying to sift through spiritual experiences or prayer that, yeah, the Lord is calling me, this is where I need to be. If that's where we work best, trying to help men say, let me just live for the church. And it's a beautiful thing that we get to be there at the early stages to help them find that mission and begin to live it.
The DSF every year is the way the Archdiocese, the way our local church, helps to sustain 60 or more programs that operate throughout the Archdiocese during the year. I am grateful to everyone who contributes to that, even by prayer. Some of you in this year who may have given in the past, quite frankly, can't give much this year. I understand that. Some of you who may actually have done a little better this year, I ask you, perhaps modestly, you might give a little more. And if you could give that little bit of help for the first time, I am deeply grateful. In these days of COVID-19, we have been tested. God has constantly brought the light of His Son Christ into view. Grateful to Jesus, beautiful light in our midst, and grateful to all of you. Thank you.
Yes, the video highlights the Catholic school office. Are we even aware that our local Catholic school district is the largest private school district in Texas? Next week, this coming week, commemorate Catholic Schools Week. But I do want to say, sure, we have wonderful, wonderful public schools with wonderful, dedicated teachers working in the public schools. But we as Catholics should be very proud. There is a unique Catholic school system that also provides quality education, but most importantly, imbued throughout all the academics in life, a Catholic faith, a Catholic ethics, a Catholic morality that a public school naturally can never offer. And yes, many of our Catholic schools provide scholarships to provide an education to lower income students or more challenging students so that they may be educated properly. And yes, our society benefits by all these young people receiving a Catholic education. The video goes on about the youth office, and we're now forming a search community committee here at our parish to find a qualified, dynamic youth minister to serve our parish. And that particular office will assist us to do so. And And yes, we always must promote vocations to the priesthood and religious life. God always calls people to serve the church in various roles. But we always need priests to lead us in worship. God calls prophets just like he called Moses in the first reading. But we need to listen to his call. And we have a role to promote vocations as a family, as a parish, and a larger church. So the people of St. Maximilian Kolbe, thank you for your generosity last year, not only for the parish weekend collections, but for exceeding our PSF amount by almost $19,000. We can make our new mandatory goal of $138,000, which is the same goal since the year 2016. Today's talk is a challenge to be who we are, to share our resources to do a good. We have the privilege to be Catholic Christians, and we have a responsibility to share the gospel. Letters and pledge cards hopefully have arrived at your homes for those who are registered parishioners. If you receive one at home, make sure it does say St. Maximilian Kolbe Parish on it. If there's another name on that parish, on that envelope, mark it out, write St. Max. We don't want to support Prince of Peace or Christ the Redeemer. You can donate online, and for those who are not registered, there are pledge cards or envelopes in the pews. Fill them out, put them in the collection basket, or bring them back after you have prayed on what a sacrificial amount is to be generous to our God, ready to share and spread the gospel. Yes, the Cardinal acknowledged that this year might be a real challenge due to economics. For others, it might not be a problem. For all of you who have been so generous with larger contributions, and if you can continue to do so, please do so. But any contribution is acceptable. For some who might be challenged specifically, consider sacrificing something, giving up a dinner or some entertainment, and then donate that money that you sacrificed by not having dinner and give it to DSF. I'm asking everyone to make some kind of pledge. No one is exempt from passing on the gospel or supporting our parish. And it should not be an afterthought either. It should be a prayerful, sacrificial decision. Last year, we had 354 participants. That is about 18% of all our registered households. Folks, we could do better than 18%, in my opinion. Your donation could be by check, credit card, stock options. Find out if your company will match your donation. I have been here 7 months, for good or worse. I know already you are an extremely generous people. So thank you. But I do have a challenge as your new pastor. By the end of June of this year, I would like to say to you that we have met our pledged amount of $138,000. Let's be honest. You didn't enjoy hearing me in November and December saying we are still short. Please give. Just do it early, get it pledged, and then we can talk about other important ways of spreading the gospel. May today we open our ears to the great needs of spreading the gospel. May we share what we have so more people can walk in the light of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Saint Maximilian Kolbe. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified in the Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. Then I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We bring our intentions to the Father this day, amazed at all the work he does in our lives.
For the Church throughout the world, may our Lord bring her safely through all the storms and trials she faces. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all government officials, may God grant them the courage to make decisions out of love, mercy, and justice, always respecting the life of every person from conception until natural death. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For families in conflict, may the grace of God move in and through them to bring about healing and reconciliation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That we may see the work of the Diocesan Services Fund as an opportunity to extend ourselves in love and service beyond the boundaries of St. Maximilian Kolbe Parish. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For our personal intentions, especially the sick and struggling, including those with mental illness and or experiencing depression. For our beloved dead, may they soon experience the fullness of God's kingdom, and for the intentions of May Ruth Knight and Barbara Coward, for whom this Mass is offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Father in heaven, thank you for every good gift. Hear our prayers as we gather in faith today, confident in your love for us. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory is without end, we acclaim.
Pray, O Lord,
Advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Daniel our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
At the Savior's command, and for my divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
And deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
In our own way, let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Thank you.
salvation. True faith may ever increase through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Once again, it's great to see you all here. Thank you for coming. Spread the word. Invite people to come physically and or watch on live stream. Ash Wednesday schedule is already in the bulletin because it's not that far off. I have written about it in my pastor's message. You know, you read these, when I write these things, I read them and I read them and I read them. I have staff read them. And then as soon as it goes to flock notes and I read it, I notice the mistake right away. It's no big deal, but just like we were trying to guesstimating on how many services to have for Christmas, we're trying to do our best to predict how many times to distribute ashes, not Holy Communion, to accommodate those who may come. So those who catch it, well, it's a mistake. Adult confirmation is beginning on Wednesday, March 3rd for any baptized Catholic who has First Holy Communion but lacks the third sacrament of initiation, confirmation. Contact the parish office and or Deacon Matt. See page 6. The Knights of Columbus will be selling tamales next weekend. Go buy them. The DSS envelopes are in the pews. It does say St. Maximilian Kolbe. Take them. We have plenty of them. Fill them up. Return them so we can do our pledge commitment in 6 months. Starting Monday is my normal day off, but Monday evening through Friday noon, I will be on retreat. So I have secured priests to come in for daily mass. Just a little teaching moment. On Wednesday is the Feast of St. Blaise, which normally has the traditional blessing of throats with the candles that go around your throat with a prayer. With COVID, there will be a blessing of throats, but not individually. The ritual allows a legitimate option, just as I bless you in a minute, that the Vietnamese priest who will be here a Wednesday will bless anyone in attendance from a distance, blessing your throats, and without the use of the traditional two candles. I'm teaching because, oh, it's different. We're making it up. No, it's in the ritual. Okay? Have a blessed day. Thank you for coming. Thank you for listening. And let our hearts always be open to God's good message and gospel. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As we depart, we joyfully sing Christ's